Five wagons grope blindly for the path on a starless night, their master glancing ever upward to the skies for assurance that he is on the right course. A dim lantern his only protection against the encroaching darkness. But the skies bring no comfort, shining no light, betraying no hint of what they know. The caravan carries travelers bound for the frontier hamlet of Gilded Vale, you among them, where a local lord has offered land and wealth to settlers from abroad looking for a fresh start. You have taken suddenly ill, sweating and shivering, and one of the other travelers signals for the caravan master to stop on your behalf. He pulls up just in time to avoid plowing into the trunk of a fallen tree that bars the way ahead. You will go no further tonight.
Thank you. Ready when you are.
I've got this.
Yeah!
Hmm?
Now I am the leader of the group.
Charge!
I'll take a peek.
Hmm?
Follow me.
Let's go!
Nice and slow. I'm here.
Follow me. Show him how it's done!
Hey there.
Steady does it.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody stays close to the wagons, got it? Stay out of the woods, and beasts take you if you were planning a stroll through those ruins up there. Whole area's crawling with hut-dwelling types who'd be happy to stick an axe in you for trespassing. So mind that you don't track mud on their sacred blazing rocks. Tonight, everybody stays put, and in the morning we'll get the path cleared. Gilded Vale's less than a day out. Understood? Touch of the rumbling rot, could be. There's a stinging beetle around here carries it. You'll be fine once it passes your innards. Unless you don't drink water, of course. Which case you'll be dead in a day. There's a berry grows in these parts, small and pink. Called a springberry. About the size of a fingernail. Give you cramps if you eat it, but the frontiersmen make a tea from it. Calms the insides. Should get you through the night. You might check around, see if you can find some. Meanwhile, I'll see if we can scare you up some water. I know you want to hunt before it gets much darker, but see about refilling our water first. Not if you hurry about your business, and not if the weather holds up. Nothing you won't see on half the hills of Air Glonfoth. Money to be made selling their knickknacks in Defiance Bay if you don't mind getting stuck with Glonfoth and arrows now and again. They didn't build them, but I'll be the effigy if they don't watch them like a mother bear. Of course, all the ones around here have been ransacked 10 times over. Got nothing left worth half a pond, so I hear. Got different names for them. Settlers called them Ingwithans. Nobody that liked them enough to stop them becoming ruins, tell you that much. This time of year, rain mostly, and wind. But there's a different kind of wind out here, time to time. Locals call it a Beowick, born out of the ether, the spirit's path. Never seen it myself, never care to. They don't got Audra where you come from? Well, it just grows up out of the ground like this. Goes deep like tree roots. Some of it all the way to the heart of the world, you believe the stories. It's more like a shell than a proper rock. Easier to work if you're a mason. Got all kinds of strange properties. Seems to have some kind of life of its own. Dies if it gets dug up. Loses its life. The soul butchers in Defiance Bay use it for different things. I've heard tell it can hold a man's soul, but I don't care to see it. Got enough to worry about without seeing something like that. They grow on a bush that's common round here, kind of funny looking. You'll know it when you see it. Doubt you'd have to go far off the road to find one. Hold on. Take someone with you. I know you're not some helpless tenderfoot, not like most of this lot. But you drop dead, I don't want to be looking for the body. Got a schedule to keep. Kalisha. He needs to find some spring berries. Watch the...
No promises.
What kind of guide says something like...
Kind you can afford.
Don't listen to her. You're in good hands. And I pay too well, if anything. Off with you. Hayadin should have supplies. See that you're equipped before you head out. We're in harsh country. Get your berries and hurry back. And if you get so much as a tickle of wind, you drop everything and you...
You heard the man. Let's get going before you keel over.
Right.
Yeah. Anyone need supplies? I've got sundries for sale. Brought a whole wagon full of goods to sell, but not enough shirts for the road. Say, is there anything you need?
With Pillars of Eternity, we strive with every level to both evoke the essence of the beloved Infinity Engine games, as well as introduce something new and engaging for players to experience in the world of Aeora. The Caravan Encampment was no exception to this goal. As the introduction area and the first impression of Aeora has to offer, it really needed to speak to the player from the get-go. Keeping in mind this principle, we needed to begin the game with an image that instilled simultaneously the feeling of adventure players may be familiar with from a Dungeons & Dragons setting, while introducing them to our own unique world. The idea of a caravan huddled around a flickering campfire both seemed familiar and befitting as the humble beginnings to a grand adventure. By setting the scene before a large ancient ruin with peculiar stone-like objects growing from the ground, we felt this would introduce them to some of the key landmarks of the Deerwood. Another principle in our design was non-linearity. Pillars of Eternity is a game about choice and consequence. We didn't want our introduction to feel like an entirely guided experience, so we opted to keep the flow of the level pretty open to exploration. Once the player has finished speaking with Odema, they are free to wander around the immediate area and examine their surroundings, even find clues that foreshadow their inevitable ambush, a situation that very quickly teaches the player the concept of consequence in our world.
This is it.
What is this? This is recent. Not good. Sparful? Are you all right? Ambush! What you need?
Huh? No! Yeah.
Let's go. Let's go.
Come on, we have to get back to camp,
Huh?
What you need?
Yeah. Yeah.
How can I help?
Huh? Right.
Let's go. Get inside!
Was that?
A Buick. Had to be.
Then we're lucky to be alive.
And we're the only ones.
We can't stay here. There could be another collapse. We're not getting out that way anyway. Let's get further inside.
Yeah.
That should be far enough. But what now?
We look for another way out. Storm has to die sometime.
The ruin of Sealant Lys was a daunting dungeon to design, but also very gratifying, as this was our chance to set the bar for our dungeons throughout the game. This was also one of the later dungeons designed during development. Oftentimes, the beginning of the game is of the last content you end up producing. This is to ensure all the systems needed to make the experience fully fleshed out are implemented and functional so they can be taught to the player properly during the first moments of gameplay. Thus, by the time this dungeon was designed, we had learned many valuable lessons about the ways we could push the layout and flow of a dungeon, as well as utilize all systems in the game that at this point had been fully fleshed out. We also felt in many RPGs the starter dungeon often felt like a bland guided experience intended on cramming tutorials down the player's throat. We certainly didn't want Sealant Lys to repeat such a formula. We didn't want the player to be completely unfamiliar with the game's core mechanics either. That being said, we opted to have a very open-ended experience for the player. Each route the player takes in the dungeon will introduce them to yet another mechanic or feature in this game, whether it be detecting traps, scouting, or the use of scripted interactions. But neither is dependent on the other.
Yeah.
The player has a choice here to choose their playstyle and be rewarded for it. The reward will then reinforce the value of this mechanic, while simultaneously teaching the player the role it plays in Pillars of Eternity.
Let's go!
Yeah. Yeah.
Where'd that slime
muck
come
on
from?
The wall. Yeah. Sure.
Wait, do you hear that?
Yeah. Right.
I could scout ahead, see what's around the corner.
Hmm?
They'll never know I'm here. Feels like there's a draft coming through that wall. I don't hear any sign of that storm either. Never know I'm here.
Yeah.
Let's go!
How can I help?
Hmm?
How can I help?
What you need?
Huh? Hmm.
Let's go!
Hmm. Yeah. Huh?
Sure.
Thank you.
Hmm?
Huh?
Oathbinder, bear witness, and see this man has kept his word true to his last breath, full to his blood's last drop. Your brother has done his part, and you have seen the power of his contribution. I will accept no further hesitation from the rest of you.
The idea of the seam came out of necessity. Initially, this was all supposed to happen somewhere inside the ruin. However, it clashed with our non-linear philosophies. In order to have the information communicated to the player about Theos and the Soul Machine, it needed to be staged just right and go off without a hitch. By placing it in the ruin itself, it meant some of the non-linearity would need to be sacrificed in order to create a hard gate for the player, so we as designers could make sure we knew the exact moment this event would be triggered. At Obsidian, we often have quests and scenarios that branch in a myriad of ways. Each of these branches are conditioned by what we call gates. These gates keep the game responding to the player by closing off paths and opening new ones based off actions they perform. A piece of dialogue, for instance, might be gated by a certain amount of disposition. This helps reinforce the suspension of disbelief for the player because to them, the world is responding according to their actions in a real way. A hard gate, however, implies a more rigid gate, one that is meant to funnel the player to a singular point by making sure the gate is only open by a singular action. In this instance, a hard gate was needed so we could know the exact position of the player as well as make sure they were not in combat or doing some other action simultaneously. This is often achieved by level transitions. Since we know the player cannot travel while in combat, we don't need to worry about that. In one scene results in the visuals of the whole level being curtailed for this one pivotal moment.
Right. Yeah. Yeah,